Are you ready? Sea of Red, it's time for another episode of Fireside Chat.
It's another week of Flames hockey, and we're getting down to the stretch here as we join you again to talk about the last week of the Flames hockey and looking ahead to what's almost the end of the season. Matt, can you believe we're in this position already?
Yeah, six games to go, and that's it. So
I don't know if maybe it's because the season hasn't been all that eventful. There hasn't been a lot of highs and lows, but it seems like it's gone by quick to me.
Yeah, well, especially with there not being this playoff push, it's been kind of slow for us, at least. I don't know about other Flames fans, but there hasn't really been a lot of excitement since December.
No, and I mean, there hasn't been, you know, the times when you'll go on a run and then everyone gets excited and then you lose a couple and then you go on a run again and you lose a couple. And, you know, the season's just kind of been ho-hum all year.
Yeah, pretty much right from the get-go.
So as of recording this on March 29th, we are now sitting at 70 points, which puts the Flames sixth from the bottom of the league with Winnipeg, Columbus, Vancouver, Edmonton, Toronto below us. And that puts us fourth place from the bottom in the West with Winnipeg, Vancouver, and Edmonton below us. So not doing too bad. In order to move up a position, we'd have to beat Arizona at 75 points, and I don't think that's going to happen. So I think that we're probably stuck between fourth and third. I could see Winnipeg overtaking us. Fourth from the bottom and third from the bottom. What do you think?
It really depends on how the Flames play their last six games. Four of them are against very good teams, between the Kings twice, Anaheim, and Minnesota. If they lose all of those and either split or lose to both Vancouver and Edmonton, then the Flames could end up falling further in the standings. I don't really see the Flames going up.
No.
Even over any of the Eastern Conference teams either.
No, I don't think they'll go up at all. I think that they're pretty much going to hold where they are or fall down.
Mm-hmm.
And at this point, falling down might not be the worst thing. I don't want them to tank. I don't want them to deliberately lose. But, you know, I think that right now it could serve us a little bit more usefully if we were lower in the standings.
Well, realistically, on odds with the draft lottery and that, the Flames will likely pick in the top six. And this year there are eight really good top-notch players. So one way or the other, the Flames will be adding one of those guys into the organization. So whether the Flames pick first, third, seventh, doesn't really matter to me.
Well, let's talk about the week that was for the Flames. Last week when our show was recorded, we had a couple games we were looking forward to and predicting. We had the Minnesota Wild was the first game of the week, the one that we saw Nick Backstrom back in net against his former team in Minnesota. And I don't think there's anything positive we can say about Backstrom in this one, especially after his first start with the Flames. The Flames got blown out 6-2. I don't really know what to say about this game besides the Flames got blown out.
Yeah, I can't really lay all the blame on Backstrom. Only the second goal that he allowed to Parise in the first period was a bad goal. Every other one, he was just getting left hung out to dry by the defense. And
I think part of that is the fact he hasn't played in so long. Like, there's a few goals that weren't necessarily his fault, but I thought if this guy was sharp and, you know, tuned, he would probably have been able to stop them.
Yeah, it probably would have been a 4-2 or a 3-2 game if he was on his game. But unfortunately, the defense did not help him out whatsoever in the contest, and it is what it is.
The only two Flames goals, the first one came in the first period from Johnny Gaudreau, his 28th of the year, assisted by Monahan and Gio. And the second one I was happy to see came from Jakub Nekladl, his second of the year, assisted by Stajan and Wotherspoon. And that was Wotherspoon's first assist this year. So good to see Wotherspoon picking up a point there. But yeah, I mean, there wasn't much to say about this Flames team. They just got outplayed. And you know, I think it was really evident in this game that the Flames are a bottom team.
Oh, for sure. And Minnesota definitely was needing the 2 points, as they were in a battle for eighth with
Colorado. And they
Colorado.
Played like it. They played like a team that needed 2 points.
Yeah. And when you're a team in our situation where the results, if you get a win, that's nice. Otherwise, who cares? Minnesota, they had something on the line. And now they've created a little bit of space between them and the Avalanche. And it's looking like that they'll end up winning the final playoff spot. So good for them. Unfortunately, it came at the expense of the Flames this week.
I have it written in my notes here. I thought that one of the keys to victory for the Wild was their takeaways. They seem to be taking the puck away from the Flames all the time. Like every time I was looking and they started an offensive rush, it seemed that they'd had a takeaway. And so I think it was just one of those things where they were just outplaying us in a lot of ways, but that's the one that I had noted here.
Mm-hmm.
They blocked and a ton more shots too.
Yeah, another interesting note was Zach Parise's hat trick in the first period was the first time a Wild player had scored a hat trick in one period.
Wow.
And in their franchise history.
If anyone's going to set a franchise record, it might as well be Parise.
Yeah, why not?
And then the goals came, as Matt mentioned, three goals from the Wild from Parise, his 20th, 21st, and 22nd. They had a goal from Jared Spurgeon in the second, a power play goal, his 9th, and another one from Jared Spurgeon in the third. Another power play goal, his 10th, and also one from Nino Niederreiter, his 19th in the third period. So, I don't know. I'm ready to move on to the next one, unless there's something else you want to talk about. I just thought this was a terrible showing by the whole team.
Yeah, well, one thing I do have to compliment is Nikolaj's slap shot. That was an amazing goal that you don't see too often anymore.
And I think
just
that's one thing.
Skating into the blue line and wiring it past the goalie.
Yeah, very old school. I think that's one thing that might earn him a full-time NHL job. I think he was sort of a bubble defenseman, but his work ethic and his shot, I think, might keep him on the team next year.
Yeah, and if you're playing him as like a number four, your team's going to suck. But he is a very flexible two-way number six, number seven type.
Oh, and yeah, I think if they sign him as a 3-4 guy, I mean, something's gone terribly wrong here. But I would be happy to see him stick around as the 6-7 guy.
And I think he's earned that in with his play this season, both in Stockton and Calgary.
And we'll talk about this later in the show, but one of the successful European free agents that we brought over, Jakub Nekladl. I think he'll probably be the first one in memory that I can think of who will probably be back for a second season.
Yeah. You wishing that the Flames had retained Roman Cervenka?
No, but I mean, I think it's good that they had that experiment and moved on from it, so it's good that this one's finally working out.
Well, who knows? The Flames may be getting another European free agent in the next couple days.
Let's go through this week's games, and we'll talk more about that a bit later.
Oh, no, I'm just setting things up for down the road.
The second game this week was back at home in the Dome, and the Flames took on the defending Stanley Cup champions. And I don't know about you, I wasn't expecting much from this game. I mean, Chicago's at the top of their game, Calgary's not. Calgary was coming off a big loss. The Flames outshot the Blackhawks 32-27. I always questioned some of the shot counts of the Dome, but ended up losing 4-1. And Matt, why don't we start with your thoughts on this one? You and I were there.
Honestly, I thought this was one of the Flames' better games that they've played recently. And outside of that really spectacularly bad pass by TJ Brody to Andrew Ladd, I thought that the Flames matched the Blackhawks punch for punch all game.
The scoreboard doesn't tell the story here. We have to remember that two of these goals were empty netters at the end.
Yeah, it was only a 2-1 game. And if you subtract that one really bad pass by TJ Brody, it was a 1-1 game. And, you know, anytime you're going against the defending Stanley Cup champions who are looking like they're going to be a favorite to repeat, and you're in a one-goal game against them where the Flames are in the standings, I find that a successful game.
Yeah, I think you're right. Like I said, I wasn't expecting a lot going in. I was pleasantly surprised by what we ended up seeing. I think it was a good game for the Flames, and I thought that the biggest thing for the Flames in this one is they were able to match pace with the Blackhawks. They didn't let the Blackhawks come out and determine how the game was going to be played, I thought. I thought that the Flames were pretty good about saying this is the way we're playing this game. This is, you know, the tempo we're going to play it at. And you could see that they were frustrating the Blackhawks. I mean, if you look at the number of roughing penalties, we had 5 roughing penalties in this game. So, you know, you could tell that the Blackhawks were getting frustrated by the Flames.
Yeah, and it was nice to see Garnett Hathaway getting under the skin of Andrew Shaw. And if Hathaway can continue to play like that moving forward into next season, I think he will establish himself as that pain in the ass agitator type guy that all successful teams seem to have.
You think he takes Bolig's job?
I think he could take either Ferland or Bolig's job, one or the other.
I think with Ferland and Hathaway both, you know, being younger and available, I think if we start the season with Bolig in a flaming C, it means that we're not, you know, giving the opportunities to those who deserve them.
Mm-hmm. Unless you're keeping Bolig as like the 13th or 14th forward.
But I'd still bury him in Stockton, bring him up when I needed him.
It depends on how much you want to have his presence in the room, whether you're playing him or not. Like, I remember when we had McGrattan in his, I think it was his last season here, and he only played like 5 or 6 times, but he was just in the organization for his presence. So I think if they kept Bolig around for that kind of a situation, that might not necessarily be the worst thing.
Yeah, okay, that's fair. But, I mean, Bolig's played 48 games this year. That can never happen again here.
No. If he's playing more than 20 next year, that's not really that good for the team.
And if you look at his time in Chicago, I mean, his first year, 2011-2012, he played 18 games. 2012-2013, he played 25 games. His last year there, he played all 82, which, you know, Chicago likes a bit of a rougher style, and that's when the enforcer had that job. In 2014-2015, he played 62 games with the Flames, and this year he's played 48. So we're seeing his, I mean, you know, he's not going to hit 62 this year. We're seeing his minutes decrease as a Flame, but yeah, I think this guy can't be playing more than 20 games next year. Other thoughts on the Chicago game? I want to compliment the other goaltender, Scott Darling. I said to you during the anthems, oh, wow, they've put their backup in, and I think you commented, wouldn't you? I've always been a fan of Scott Darling's. I've liked him as a goalie. I think Scott Darling's going to be that next backup guy to sort of break out as a starter in the right market, sort of like we've seen with Corey Schneider, who is Lou's backup and that sort of thing. I think that he's going to break out, and not necessarily in a market like Chicago, but maybe a market like an Edmonton or Toronto or Winnipeg. I could see them bringing him in and him becoming a serviceable starter for one of those teams. So I was quite pleased by how Darlene played.
Would you want him to come to Calgary as the goalie solution for next year?
I think he could be good for that. I wouldn't pay a lot for him, and I wouldn't look at him as a long-term solution, but he might be a good stopgap, a good, you know, 1-2 year solution until we find out what we've got in Gillies. I wouldn't bring this guy in and say, all right, goalie problems are solved, we can head towards the playoffs. I'd bring him in and say, okay, you know, we got a capable, serviceable NHLer. You put somebody like an Ordeo to back him up. And, you know, we don't know what Darlene would play like with a big workload, but every time I've seen him, he seems pretty consistent, which leads me to believe he'll probably do okay with a bigger workload.
Yeah. And credit to Freddie Hamilton assisting his brother to get his career-high 11th goal of the season.
That's right. Dougie got his 11th goal, and Freddie assisted it. Got his first assist as a Flame. I think his first, does he have a goal before this?
Yeah, he has 2 goals in his career and now 1 assist.
And that was a pretty good play too. You could tell that Freddie, he barely even looked over, saw Dougie and just gave him the puck.
Yeah.
And I mean, Freddie's had a pretty good run here with the Flames. He's been playing with Gaudreau. He's been playing with his brother. I mean, they've treated this kid really well.
Mm-hmm. It'll be interesting to see what the Flames do with their depth forwards, because of the fact that all the guys that have come in have played really well, and some of the more veteran guys that are in our bottom six have not. So might be seeing guys like Bolig, like Stajan, and some others possibly even moving on. or just getting relegated to Stockton like Mason Raymond next year.
I mean, we were seeing that last year with, you know, a lot of the young call-ups coming in. We haven't had as many this year until just recently. But, yeah, I agree with you. I think that this is going to cause some competition. I think at the year-end meetings, we're going to, you know, be seeing the coaching staff telling the Flames, hey, look, you know, these kids are on your butt. And for a guy like Stajan, these kids have been, you know, right on your tail for a couple of years now. So you're going to have to really come out of training camp and show us you've still got it. Or, you know, we may have to go a different direction.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, no, I definitely think it's going to be interesting to see what happens next year. And I think the fact that the Flames, as and I've said this before, but as a team who was for years told the cupboards are bare, you know, fans were told there's no good prospects here, to now be saying, hey, we've got some good prospects, and, you know, seeing some of those exciting prospects, I think that's awesome.
And that you're seeing players that can legitimately take spots from other guys as well.
Well, that's what, like, I mean. We're not seeing, just like the next Sidney Crosby or the next, you know, Bennett, but we're seeing these young guys who are showing they've got NHL chops potentially.
Mm-hmm.
And yes, they're going to be, you know, second, third, fourth line guys. I'm not looking at any of these guys we've called up as a number one next year. But, you know, sometimes you start as a third line guy and you work your way up. I think some of them might get there, but I don't see any of them getting that spot next year.
No, and realistically, this team, for them to be successful, they need to have four lines of quality players, not just Gaudreau and Monahan being awesome, and then a bunch of so-so players after that. They need to have all 12 of their forwards being good if they want to win the Stanley Cup in the future.
And I think outside of just being good, I think the biggest thing to remember is after signing a new Monahan and Gaudreau deal, they're going to need their forwards to be cheap. And that's the nice thing about bringing a lot of these young guys up is they're making sub $1 million.
Yeah, and even if they get re-signed, like a guy like Colborne, he's not going to be demanding like $3 or $4 million. At least not for another, like, 4 or 5 years. And that's if he continues to play like he is this year. So we'll still have a lot of cheaper contracts, even if they are playing relatively successfully in their roles.
For sure, Matt, I agree. It'll be interesting to see what happens with guys like that and what they earn going forward. In the last game of the week, the Calgary Flames took on the Arizona Coyotes in Arizona. And this was a game that I wasn't really expecting much for from, again, looking at what happened. So the Flames had some major roster moves that were made here. It was announced early in the day that Johnny Gaudreau, Josh Jooris, and Jykri Jokipakka were all out with injury. And so the Flames recalled Derek Grant, Hunter Shinkaruk, Emile Poirier, and Brett Kulak all on emergency basis. And also Hathaway and Hamilton were reassigned back to Stockton. So we had a ton of players going up and down. If there's, and again, I don't like to say teams are tanking, but if the Flames were ever trying to put themselves in a position to lose, this would have been it. I've seen so many young players and not Gaudreau, and they still managed to win.
Well, that's emblematic of what I was mentioning about the bottom six forwards on the team. You bring up four prospects who've only played a handful of games this season between them, and each of them plays successfully in the game, and the depth guys, like the fourth line, was by far the Flames' worst line last night. Bolig, he struggled, Stajan, he struggled, and Boma struggled. Whereas the four guys that came in, they all played very effectively in their minutes. It'll be interesting to see as this moves forward whether or not those guys can actually show well enough where they can actually steal spots.
Yeah, I mean, I was sort of surprised by who they brought up. I thought Grant obviously deserved it. I didn't expect to see Shinkaruk brought up this year. Kulak makes sense because he started here. And Poirier was a guy that I had a feeling they'd probably bring up just because they want to see what they've got, and he's had an up-and-down year. But I didn't honestly expect to see him play. And I thought We'll talk about it, but I thought they all played pretty well considering the travel day they had and just getting in and, you know, that sort of thing. Not even, I don't think, practicing with the team. So Emile Poirier was wearing number 28. He was one of those guys that got a real number, if you will, as a guy who was expected to potentially, you know, make the team. It's his first NHL game since last year. He played 14 minutes and 3 seconds, 13:07 at even strength, and 56 seconds on the power play. Had 2 shots, 3 hits, and a minor penalty that resulted in a waved-off goal from Arizona. I thought that it was interesting putting him on a line with Backlund and Frolik, and I actually quite liked that line. What do you think of Poirier?
Well, for the large portion of his season in Stockton, he's been learning how to play more effectively in a two-way role. And when he is generating offense, he's trying to get into spots that he can use his good slap shot release. And we did even see that in the game. One of his 2 shots was a feed from, I believe, Backlund for a one-timer. His game, he's trying to make himself a long-term NHL player, and in order to do that, you need to be able to play at both ends of the ice. And I thought putting him on a line with Backlund and Frolik, the 2 defensively responsible Flames forwards, made a lot of sense because they're successful in that, the game that he's trying to develop into. And I thought he played very well. He just missed a couple of times with passes and such. There was one pass from the blue line that if it had hit his stick, he would have scored. But overall, I thought he had a really successful game.
I was going to say, when I look at Poirier, it reminds me of the conversation I had with Theo Fleury earlier this year. And Fleury said that when you're coming into the AHL and as a new NHLer as well, most of these guys are learning how to play without the puck. They're so used to always have the puck. You know, it's pass the puck to this guy, pass the puck to this guy. That's what the coaches tell them at the CHL junior level. And so I think for Poirier, we're seeing that, is we're seeing him learning not just the defensive side of the game, but what do you do when that puck's not on your stick? And how do you go about getting that puck back on your stick? And to me, I think that's what I've been seeing and what I've seen of his game so far in Stockton.
Yeah, and it's not a situation where you go from playing the game one way to playing it a completely different way and be successful in 6 months. It usually takes a couple of seasons to work out all the kinks, and he has made a lot of strides, especially in the defensive end. It's gonna take some time. He's on track, though, and I don't think that he'll ever be a top 6 forward, but he will probably end up developing into a pretty elite third line forward for the Flames.
I think he's going to be a third line guy who's going to get a lot of special teams time.
Yeah, both on the penalty kill and the power play.
Yeah, I think you'll see him more on the PP, more on the PK than on the PP. But I think he'll do both, and I think he'll chew up a lot of minutes on both power play and penalty kill.
Yeah, well, especially with his speed, like, if you're on the penalty kill, like, you can just imagine how many breakaway chances he's going to get with his foot speed.
And if they can create him into a more defensive-minded player, like it looks like they're trying to, he's going to be great on the penalty kill as well.
Mm-hmm. The player they're trying to mold him into is the type of player that you win a cup with, not just you throw him out there and he does whatever.
The next guy on the list that I was looking at the stats for is a guy who we brought over and traded the deadline. This was Hunter Shinkaruk, who we brought over in the Granlund deal. He's played in the NHL this year, but this is his first NHL game since November. He's a Calgary boy, and he got his first win with the Flames. Also, his first point is a Flame, which is pretty cool. He played 14:56, 13 minutes and 11 seconds at even strength, and 1:45 on the power play. Got 2 shots and an assist. Arguably, that assist should be a goal. I thought it was right away, and I was pretty sure they'd change it, but didn't. And it was interesting to see the top line last night. It was a lot of the game, Shinkaruk, Monahan, and Grant. And I thought that Shinkaruk, you know, looked good out there with Monahan. He's not going to play there all the time, but I was impressed by what we saw from Shinkaruk in this game. What about you?
Oh, I was thrilled with his game. He brought a lot more physicality than I was expecting. That was one of the complaints that Canuck fans had with him, was that he wasn't overly engaged physically, and that hit that he threw on Domi was very good. He was all over the ice, he was buzzing. Whether he can bring that consistently in each game is yet to be seen, but if he continues to play like that, putting him out with Sam Bennett, the pair will be a wrecking ball force out there. And it'll be interesting to see if he does play like that, where he does slot up in the lineup eventually.
This is a guy who I could see taking Stajan's role next year.
How so?
I think that he's the centerman that Stajan should be and isn't. I think he's
plays... he's not a center, though.
He can play center. He's a left wing. He's played some center.
Okay.
I mean, you could put him at left, but we got so many left wingers, I can't see them putting him there. So I think they'd play him at center. I think that he could take that sort of physical... I mean, Stajan's great in the room, don't get me wrong, but I think that we might see Shinkaruk kind of playing that energy role that I think they've been trying to push Stajan into.
Okay, I disagree.
Where do you think they'd slot him in?
I think that you would more likely see him on the second line.
You think you'd bring him in
more
as a second?
So, I think he has more scoring than just being a depth guy.
I think he does, but I don't think it's developed yet. I think he'd probably start on the third line, bring him in there, and I think he'd have to earn his way to the second line. If I look at that second line now, I'm not sure he's quite ready to be with Backlund and Frolik.
No. Well, I think that you'd probably throw him on the third line to start with either Bennett or Backlund, depending on whichever way you figure that lineup
out.
Yeah,
I think he'll get to the second line, but I wouldn't feel comfortable just giving him that position from what we've seen so far right out of camp. I think he's going to have to work his way up.
Oh, for sure.
And he wore number 49 last night. I think he wore 48 for the Canucks this year.
Yeah, I think so.
So 49 for the Flames, and he's been wearing 16 on the farm.
Yeah. Well, we'll see if he does make the team next year, what number he gets assigned. I'm sure that he won't be sticking with 49.
We didn't think Ferland would stick with 79 either.
True.
The next guy that we brought up was a player we've seen so far this year. This was his 10th game, and he's now waiver eligible. It's number 57, Derek Grant. His 34th NHL career game, he played 16 minutes, 45 seconds, 228 on the penalty kill, 45 seconds on the power play, and 1303 even strength, it looks like. He had one faceoff win and took two of them. Two shots and one assist. He ends up the night with a plus one rating. Derek Grant, I mean, he's coming off a big injury. He's no longer waiver eligible, so this is a guy that the Flames obviously think they'll probably hang on to at the NHL level. To me, Grant was what I expected. If you remember early in the year, he sort of played the game that we've seen to some extent that we've seen Hathaway play since his recall. He was that gritty guy. He was almost the Lance Boma this year. He was the gritty and the offense all at once. I thought that Grant looked like a guy who hasn't played in a while, but I think that there's still some potential there.
I honestly, for me, this is Matt Stajan's replacement next year on the fourth line.
That
he's
could be.
One of the top face-off guys in the NHL. And in his time in Calgary earlier this season, and his two-way play allows the flexibility for the team to put him with offensive players if need be. He would obviously help the penalty kill just by the availability for him to actually win faceoffs.
I think him, Ferland, and Boma could be a very interesting fourth line.
Yeah, I agree with you there. And I honestly, at where I'm sitting right now, I do not see Matt Stajan on this team next year. There are just too many guys that have leapfrogged him in the organization.
Well, I think not only have leapfrogged him, but when we look at the new contracts that will be signed, Matt Stajan's all of a sudden going to be very expensive. We've been able to keep him, I think, for a while just because his contract is manageable. But I think that contract now, after the new Gaudreau-Monahan, we're going to look and go, wow, this guy's really expensive for what he's doing for us.
Yeah, and you would keep him in the organization. Like, I don't see any team actually taking Matt Stajan, but for an expansion draft the following year, the Flames will have to expose a quarter of their cap, so keeping Stajan around just for that, I could see, but I would have him playing in Stockton next year.
Yeah, I could see that. And, you know, he's a great leader, and I think that he could be great, you know, helping some of those young guys as the leader. I could see them throwing him in Stockton and giving him the C.
Yeah, same here.
And unlike Mason Raymond, I don't think he's being banished because he's terrible. It's almost at this point, he's the odd man out. Big contract, hungry guys. I don't think that he's been terrible this year. He hasn't played up to his potential. But, I think if Stajan was making $1 million, we'd probably say let's bring him back next year.
Probably not.
You don't think so?
No, I think that he's probably 17th or 18th on the forward depth chart right now.
I guess I'm saying that just because he's supposed to be so great in the room, and I think that there's value to that. I think you would, if he was making $1 million, you'd make room by moving out a guy, maybe like a Bolig, to keep him. But I don't know. There's something to be said for those veterans in the room, and Stajan's great in the community. I think that it would be a loss to the Flames if he's gone.
Yeah, I'm not saying that like off ice, it wouldn't be. It would be a good thing to keep him, but the always earn, never given mantra that the Flames have, he has fallen far enough where enough players have leapfrogged him that I just don't see a situation where he's not, like, where he is in the lineup next year.
You could be right. It'll be interesting to see what happens. And I think
put it this way, I think if any team actually offers to take him in trade for some reason, like they need a fourth line center, then I would see the Flames dealing him pretty much without question.
The thing that I think has been the biggest downfall for Stajan is I think the Flames are asking him to play a role that's not him. I don't think that he is that sort of energy third, fourth line centerman. And I think he's being sort of shoehorned into that. But I think if he could go somewhere and play more of the two-way forward with a bit of an offensive upside type guy, he'd fare better.
I just don't know where.
No, me neither. And again, that could be an expansion team. That might be a good place to reestablish yourself.
I just think that he's lost a little bit of his foot speed, and that's causing a lot of the problems this year.
Yeah, you could very well be right. And the last player that we brought up, number 61, who we saw earlier this year, Brett Kulak. This is his first game since October, and I believe his 8th or 9th total in the NHL. He played the least of all these guys at 14:55 and had 2 shots. I didn't think that we got a good look at Kulak last night. It didn't seem like the coaching staff was really all that fond of him. He didn't get a lot of, I didn't think, good minutes, but he played mostly with McLaughlin in England, and he had pretty relatively easy opposition every time he was on the ice.
Yeah, he made a couple of decent defensive plays. He didn't stand out as being particularly bad in any situation. The only mistake that he made was that one play in the third period where he tried to stop the one guy, Seacatch, from breaking in on net, and he got deked out by him, but other than that, I thought he was okay.
I want to be careful how I say this. I don't want to devalue Kulak. I think Kulak has an upside. I still think there's a place for him. I don't think that he's the next defenseman on the depth chart. And if he is, I think that that's a little bit worrisome.
I can agree with that. And that's, again, not any slight to Kulak. It's the team,
we have too many interchangeable 5, 6, 7 guys when I look around.
Yeah.
And I think unless a player was moved, if they were to move in England or, you know, somebody like that, then maybe he has a spot. But if I'm looking at the rare few spots that we're going to have, I would rather put a guy like Nikladal in there. I'd rather put, you know, somebody else into those spots. I just hope that he's not the guy who makes the team over like a Nikladal or a, you know, a Shillington or somebody like that. I'm hoping that if he's the next guy up and he makes that team next year without another piece being moved. I mean, if they move Weidman in England or something, we have spots, maybe. But I just don't think that he should be that next guy on the block.
He would have to take another step or two in his development up in order to make himself a full-time NHL player. Whether he has that in him or not is still to be seen, but...
And I think we've seen enough work from him this year, both through October and what we'll probably see for the rest of the year, that I think we can make a fair assessment of what he has or what he doesn't have. And I think they'll keep him around the organization, but I just don't think he's that next guy that maybe they thought he was. He's one of the older guys. I think maybe they thought, okay, it's his time. And I don't think it is yet.
Yeah.
I think it could be, but I don't think it is yet.
I would think that he has the potential and the talent to be a player in the NHL. I just don't know if it'll be with us or how that would all break down. Especially with the type of players that the Flames have coming up in the organization and the possibility that the Flames may draft another top-tier defenseman this draft. There's just not enough spots in the organization for him, I don't think.
No, and I mean, I think that might be good. It'll make him compete for a spot, but overall, I think that, yeah, if he's better, let's just say he's the best defenseman of all the young defensemen we have, I think that's bad for looking at the development of our young defensemen, because to me, we have a lot of guys who should be more promising than him, and even guys who might have taken a step back this year, like a Kenny Morrison. I think it's tough to judge somebody after, you know, one pro year. But when I look at the defensemen that we have, you know, Shillington should be better. Watherspoon should be better. Morrison should be better. You know, Seeloff, you could debate if he should be better or not. You know, I think that there's a lot of younger guys who should be better. So it'll be interesting to see what happens with Kulak going forward. I think that he's going to be a good AHL guy. I think he'll be a good call-up guy, and I think he's one of these guys that we'll probably keep calling up till he becomes waiver eligible and then you decide what to do, almost like a Drew Shore almost of the defenseman. But I don't see him having a full-time job here next year.
No.
Or even starting the year here. I think it was a fluke that he started the year here this year. He had a good camp, but I don't think it necessarily means that he's NHL ready. Some other interesting news from this game. We've talked about the young players. I thought it was interesting the goaltending tandem that the Flames went with. They went with Joni Ordio in net, as we know, and they sat Nicklas Backstrom as the backup goaltender. Hiller was scratched, and I talked to you about this in the Chicago game. I said I'd be putting Hiller on the bench, or not on the bench, in the press box, and Backstrom on the bench, because I think that Backstrom, at least is of his two games, 50% of those games were... He got a win in 50%, and like you said, he wasn't too bad in the other one. It wasn't his fault, but I thought it was interesting that they gave Backstrom the backup. Not that he's going to play, but, you know, I think it says something about Hiller and where the organization might be thinking of him.
Yeah, well, I think that the Flames are possibly going to play Backstrom again at some point. Especially against Minnesota at the end of the year.
Do you see Hiller getting another start?
No. Honestly, I think Hiller, the last game against Toronto was his last game as a Flame.
Yeah, no, I agree with you. I think that Hiller's probably done as a Flame. I mean, we've given him chances, and he just hasn't risen to the occasion.
No.
And it's tough to keep giving him chances when, you know, there's no reason, and we really need to give Ordio. And I could even see, depending on where we are and where Stockton is, potentially giving Poulin a chance at the end of the year.
Maybe.
You'd be carrying four goalies, which would be weird, but...
Yeah, I don't necessarily think that would happen, but
the only
stranger
reason
things
I could
happen.
Yeah, the only reason I could potentially see that is Nick Schneider's joining Stockton. So if they're not in a playoff spot, I could see them giving Schneider a game and then promoting Poulin for a game.
Yeah, that would probably be the Vancouver game in Calgary if they're going to do that.
Yeah, I don't think it will happen, but I also wouldn't be shocked if it did, let's put it that way.
Mm-hmm.
Matt, you noted in this game that Michael Frolik missed part of the game. Frolik left in, what, the second, I think?
Yeah.
And he didn't return. He left with an injury. The coach kind of blew it off afterwards and said, well, he's not doing that bad. You know, we'll assess him tomorrow. But this could be an injury. You've heard that he may miss some more games.
Well, I would think that, like Gaudreau and Jokipakka, if the Flames were in a playoff push, I think that both of those guys would have played last game. And I think Frolik may just sit, perhaps, for both the Anaheim and LA game, just due to allowing some of the younger players play and in the emergency situation instead of throwing Frolik out there.
Yeah, there's no reason to put him out if he's not 100%. There's arguably no reason to even put him out if he is 100%. I think anyone that leaves the game for any reason, even if it's a hangnail, will probably end up sitting, you know, the next game to try out some new bodies.
And why not? We only have one remaining call-up, so if you can...
One remaining regular call-up and an indefinite amount of emergencies.
Yeah, which they have to get rid of that rule. It's so stupid.
But yeah, I don't understand it myself. Like, you know, if you want to call up your whole AHL team and you're out of the playoffs, why not?
That's what I think as well. Like, you might as well just allow teams to... Like, if they're out of it and they want to try out 11 or 12 new guys just to get a game here and there, why not allow them to do that?
I could see maybe, you know, at the deadline saying, okay, if you're within so many points of a playoff spot or your hopes are still alive, we put a limit on you. If you're done, there's no limit.
Yeah, like if you're in the bottom, say, 8 in the standings or 10,
yeah,
then where you're out of it, then...
Yeah, because I can understand the rule from a team going to the playoffs that, okay, you've got to manage that carefully, but why not allow Calgary, Edmonton, Toronto to bring up their whole AHL roster if they want to?
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, I think that that might be something that we see tweaked in the next CBA. I think it would be minor, but for the teams that need it, it would be very helpful. Because, yeah, I think the whole thing of, oh, we only have so many call-ups is kind of stupid. And you see teams trying to circumvent it anyways, like the Flames. I mean, I doubt that all these guys were injured, if you will, to find injury. But, you know, it's, oh, I don't feel well today, or I'm tired. Well, okay, we're sitting you down, you know?
You're injured.
Well, that's it, yeah.
Yeah.
So I think if the teams are going to circumvent the rule anyways, why not just get rid of the rule?
Yeah.
And the league doesn't seem to care when teams circumvent it, so that tells me that, you know, if they're not going to enforce it, it'll probably go away.
Yeah. And that would make sense for a lot of teams.
Yeah.
Because it doesn't really matter.
No, I mean, you know, you don't have a number of recalls during the year. I could see them being worried if teams had players that were, you know, just sent down, like, you know, a Mason Raymond or Matt Stajan who might have some NHL potential, and maybe that's where the rule says, okay, you can bring up any guy making less than 1.5, and you can only bring up one guy who's making more than that or something like that, if they're worried about teams just sending NHL players to the farm and then recalling them. But there's got to be a way to work this out.
Yeah.
Anything else about this week that you want to chat about? With the games that were played?
Not really. The Flames won one game. They lost two. That's pretty much how the season's gone.
Isn't it, though?
The young players played well, which is always encouraging. Monahan and Hamilton are close to matching their seasons from last year. Monahan's down to 3 points back and Hamilton 2 points back. So that's pretty good.
Which in a rough year is good to see.
So that would pretty much mean that, like, all of the players that are the key players for the Flames are having career years. So that's encouraging for next year and beyond. It's just the other 12 players are playing so poorly that's the reason why the Flames are where we are. Other than that, like,
and
there's encouraging things.
And that's the way it works, though, you know? You need, I think now more than ever in the NHL, you need to have a full team if you're going to win.
And, like, the top eight guys are basically playing as good as they did last year. It's just the rest of the team fell off the face of the earth, and that's why the Flames are in lottery pick zone instead of probably playing Anaheim in round one.
And I have faith that Trilobin will sort it out. He might not be able to get it all sorted out this summer, but I think that he will get it sorted out by the time it matters. Oh,
yeah. Well, if the Flames get a quality goaltender and they sort out some of the depth problems, then they should be fine.
Yeah, I mean, you can solve the goaltending problem in one acquisition. Yeah. You acquire one goalie and your goaltending woes could be solved. Any other position like right wings, it might take a couple of years because there's four of them. So you might need a couple off seasons to finish a cycle there. Or even on defense, you might need a couple of years to finish out a cycle there.
I agree. And they might be able to get a forward through free agency, whether that's a guy like Backes or Okposo or whatever. But
that doesn't solve your woes. That's just another piece.
Yeah, exactly.
We were talking about young guys earlier. Why don't we jump to some other young guys in the organization? Matt, you were, I believe you were a fan of the Jankowski pick when we made it, weren't you?
I was pretty much the only person on Calgary Puck who knew who Jankowski was when we made the pick.
I was shocked when we made the pick. I didn't know what to think. And as I've seen Jankowski at development camps, at, you know, college games online, I've started to warm up to the guy. But it's time for the Flames to decide what they're going to do with Jankowski. So they have a couple options. They can try to get him signed before July 1. If they don't, he becomes an unrestricted free agent. And if they don't sign him, they will get a compensation second-round pick. So that becomes like the 31st pick, I think, right, in the second round?
The 51st overall selection in 2017.
There you go. Okay. And then they have a couple options if they can get him signed of what to do with him. So they can do what we've seen them do with guys like Gaudreau in the past, where you bring him in, you let him play a game or two and burn a year of his contract. They could sign him and send him to Stockton, and he can play in Stockton without burning a year of the contract. Or they could not sign him. I mean, maybe we think that we're better getting a second-round pick for this guy. Matt, what do you think?
Well, apparently the main sticking point is performance bonuses with the contract. Apparently teams are only allowed X number of dollars total in performance bonuses for players that are on the team. And if the Flames say they sign whomever their first round pick is and they play in the NHL, they're going to get the max bonuses. You have Bennett who's going to have max bonuses. That would pretty much take up all of that bonus space. So that would make it so that Jankowski would not be able to play in the NHL next year. Which,
you could debate if that's good or bad.
If he does sign for...
You could debate if that'd be good or bad if Jankowski doesn't play in the NHL. I still think this kid probably needs a year of AHL seasoning.
Yeah, but they're trying to get him to sign without... Like, if he... Most of the bonuses are for, like, league-wide awards, which... Basically, if he's playing at the level that Gaudreau did last season, then he would get some of the bonuses. And the odds of him doing that are marginal at best.
Yeah.
So that's the sticking point at this point. Whether that gets sorted out or not, I still think the Flames will sign him to a contract. It's just figuring out all the details.
Yeah, and I mean, if I look at the guys that he'd be competing against with bonuses, I don't think that Jankowski would be my first guy to spend all the bonus money on. I could see Jankowski going down to the wire to get this signed. I think this might end up being a bit of a game of chicken between his agents and Calgary. I think he'll sign here by July 1st. I just don't expect him. I'm not expecting him to play a game in the Flaming Sea this season.
Honestly, I think if the Flames don't play him in a game this season, the Flames will end up losing him to free agency. Because that's the only incentive that they have, is that they can burn a year of his contract. So
see, and I'm not, I understand why the players want, I'm not a whole fan of that. Like, you've just signed on with a team in good faith, and all of a sudden it's, well, I'm signing on with you in good faith, I want to be a long-term piece here, but it's okay, I'll just burn a year. And again, I think that might be something that the league has to look at in the next CBA of how that all works. Because I understand why the player wants it, but to me it's sort of, it's not a good faith move for the player towards that team.
Yeah. One of the suggestions, like, because Jimmy Vesey decided to not sign with Nashville, that I heard someone bring up is that the NFL apparently, like, for players that don't sign, that another team, like, they have, like, a supplementary draft where any team can throw their best offer of a draft pick at for that player, and that player has to sign with that team. So say we wanted Vesey, we could throw, say, our second round pick and we would get him.
So it's sort of a, you know, is it really that bad in Calgary, or do I want to, you know, who knows where I'll go? I might end up going to Edmonton or Winnipeg. I might as well just sign here.
Yeah, and I think that would help to eliminate the problem with the NCAA's loophole where, oh, well, I'm from Toronto, I'd want to sign with Toronto, even though Nashville spent 4 years developing me.
Yeah.
You know, screw them, because I'd rather play where I want to. Like, yeah. It's not fair to the team that spent all the time and effort developing the player.
No, and I mean, you know, again, I understand where the player is coming from, but I could see, I think it's what, to be classified playing a season at the NHL level, you have to play 25 games, if I remember correctly. Like, for a player to be seen as playing a season and be eligible for any awards.
Yeah.
So I could see, I think it'd be very easy to say, if you sign a contract and play less than 25 games in your first season, you don't burn it. You know, like, playing one game wouldn't burn that deal. It'd just be seen, especially if the player signs after the deadline, it's just seen as then rolling over the next year.
Well, that would also work against any teams that are trying to sign their own guys as well.
It could, yeah.
Because that's the main incentive, is that my contract will be over sooner so I can make more money down the road.
Yeah, no, I understand that. But I think that, again, if you're looking at it from the owner's perspective, that, you know what, I'm investing in this guy. I don't want to invest, you know, for 2 years when I could have got 3 years.
Mm-hmm.
So I think what you might see them doing is creating some sort of a system after the deadline where the NHL can bring players in on a tryout agreement, which really you can't do right now. There's some weird cases where you can, but the NHL doesn't generally allow players in a tryout agreement. So have some sort of like an amateur tryout where we bring the guy in, we see how he looks, and then we can sign him after that. But, you know, I understand why the players like it, but to me it doesn't sit well with me. I'm committing long term to you, but I want to burn my first year.
Yeah.
But, you know, a 6'3" left shooting centerman who weighs 170 pounds, which is what we have in Jankowski.
Well, he's over 200 now. That's an old number.
Okay. So, you know, a guy like that, if the Flames don't sign him, he will find work at the NHL level.
Oh, for sure. Like, I'm sure that 29 teams would like Jankowski, because how often do you get a quality two-way center that's 6'3", 6'4"? They just don't grow on trees. Like, and he does have offensive upside, so the Flames need to bite the bullet and sign him. Like, I think that would be, of all the crap that has happened in the Flames season, not signing Jankowski would be the biggest fail of the season. In my opinion.
And I just hope it doesn't come down to an ego thing of, you know, this is the old guard's pick, or, you know, this is a Feaster pick. And, you know, I hope they just realize that this is a good hockey player, and, you know, he may never make it where we want, but let's give the guy a 3-year contract, burn one, and see what he's got for 2 years.
Yeah. And realistically, next year's draft is not very good from all that I've heard. So the 51st pick is likely going to get you a significantly inferior prospect by orders of magnitude, not just a little bit worse, but like significantly worse. So like going from Jankowski to like Kenny Agostino caliber difference. So, and then we'll have to wait another 3 or 4 years to see if that player figures it out. So, overall, it would be pretty much a disaster if the Flames don't sign him.
Well, let's hope that they get the bonuses sorted out. I mean, if you remember, too, when we were signing Gaudreau, there were some thoughts that that might not get done, and there were some holdups there, not so much around the bonuses, but with the parents wanting to play his last year, and they managed to get that one done. So I have no doubt that if the Flames want this done, it'll get done.
Yeah.
I think, like you said, it would be a black eye for this organization to let a former first-round pick who has some potential. It's not like we're talking about Rico Fatt or Daniel Tkachuk here. First-round pick with some potential go to free agency. But so overall, I mean, I understand what the player wants. If you could pick what happened with this guy, what would you do with him? You sign him? Would you bring him up and play him this year in the NHL? Would you sign him to Stockton? Sure.
Yeah, he could play every one of the remaining games if he wanted.
Can't hurt to play him with where we are right now.
No, and he needs to learn how much room he needs to, like how much further he needs to go in order to be an NHL or full-time. So, like, even if you sat staging and just threw him as the fourth line center for each game.
Or find a way for staging to get injured.
Yeah. Oh, you've got a paper cut. You get to sit on the sidelines.
You got a headache. Sit out. So, we'll see what happens with Janko, and hopefully next week on our show we'll be talking about the signing of Jankowski.
Yeah, and how he played in his first games. All that fun stuff, so.
Another name that we wanted to talk about here was Daniel Pribyl, who's a European prospect, and we know how this has worked out for the Flames in the past, but he's one of the highly sought out guys from the Czech League, and he has narrowed his choices for NHL teams, according to sources like Bob McKenzie, to Pittsburgh, Nashville, and Calgary. This guy is 6'3", 215 pounds. He has 45 games played, 16 goals, 29 assists for 45 total points in the Czech League, and he's second in scoring only behind a former Flame, Roman Cervenka. I understand the Flames wanting to do this. Now, Pribyl was drafted. He was drafted in 2011 by the Canadiens in the sixth round and never signed. Now he's a free agent. And I understand why the Flames would want to go after this guy, but I still have a bad taste in my mouth from some of the previous European free agents that we've signed. I mean, we had Cervenka, who didn't work out. We had David Wolf, who didn't work out. I think that having Nekladal this year, who did, is a nice, we got to have one somewhere that works. Matt, do you know anything about this kid and what we might expect if he signed with the Flames?
Well, one of the concerns that Canadiens fans had and the team itself had is that he is not physical whatsoever. So despite his size, he's not a physical guy. More or less, he's a Joel Colborne-esque type player. Solid. Good hands, can score. He's physically bigger, and overall, he's a decent player. If the Flames do end up signing him, he will more than likely be a third line right winger for the Flames. I don't see him magically developing into a first line forward to throw opposite Gaudreau and Monahan. But he could end up being a decent secondary option for the team.
The analysis that I've read that I think is best summing him up from what I've talked to people who've seen him is on hockeysfuture.com, and it says, a bit of a late riser, Preble's a work in progress, whose height, long reach, and soft hands make him a capable goal scorer. Despite that height, he's not overly physical and has not demonstrated the ability to consistently battle in small areas. As with many players of his height, his skating balance and overall agility are issues, but should improve as he matures. Pribyl's positional play is also a bit of an unknown at this point, but coaches who've worked with him compliment his work ethic and determination to improve. And I guess we look at it from the fact that this guy, is going to be another piece in the puzzle. It doesn't mean he's got to come to the NHL. He might be like David Wolf, where he plays most of his time in the AHL and maybe gets a look here and there. Even look at, Nekladal, who spent most of the year in the AHL. I think it can't hurt to have another piece in the organization, but I wouldn't expect Daniel Pribyl to make the NHL roster next year.
He could, but he would have to have a good training camp and all that.
I think the only reason he might is because he's a right winger.
Yeah.
And we need right wingers so badly that I think they might just put him in there because he plays right wing. So
it can't hurt. You're basically getting another Joel Colborn, which the Flames can use. Anytime you're getting somebody that's bigger in size, that helps. If he develops, hey, that's great, free asset. If not, well, hey, you try it again. So,
do you think that we would sign him like we've seen with all our other European imports to a one-year deal?
I think, because of his age, it's a two-year entry level.
Okay.
So
even 2 years, no harm, no foul. I think we've got some guys who may not be back. We may have some other prospects we might not sign. So why not give him a chance? If he's got to play in the A, he's got to play in the A. And, after 2 years, we can cut bait. But, looking at their history, the European prospect thing hasn't worked out as well for Flames. And mind you, we've generally taken older players, 25, 26, 27. So bringing in a guy who's 23, we might still be able to mold him into a Calgary Flame.
And the more shots you take, eventually you're going to get one that works really well. And the Flames were the runner-up for Artemi Panarin, who's been thoroughly successful for Chicago. So if that had worked out in our favor, then we would have another first-line forward. So,
well, even if Nicolato comes back next year, I'd say that was a win.
True. So
maybe we just have to bring in European blue liners.
You never know with any of these guys. The more shots you take, though, you're just odds wise, you're gonna eventually find some players that are good.
Yeah, and looking at our cap scenario and our contract scenario, it's not like we're at 50 contracts. We're to bring this kid in, we got to get rid of somebody. I think we have 47 contracts right now, so we can bring him in and not, cost us anything really. I'd be a little more hesitant if it was to bring in Pribyl. We have to get rid of somebody. But, if we have the contract space, for those that don't know, you can only carry 50 pro contracts under the NHL CBA. So I think we're at 47. I'm just going to double check here. So why not bring him in, use one of those contracts? We're at 46 right now. Mason McDonald, Rasmus Anderson, Brett Pulock, Andrew Mangiapane, and Nick Schneider don't count. So 46. So, you bring him in at 47, you still got a couple to burn after that. There's no reason not to.
Yeah. Worst case scenario is he's an AHL player and he goes away after mm-hmm. 2 years. So why not?
If not earlier. I mean, if he doesn't work out and there's other teams like Nashville and Pittsburgh who, if he doesn't work out after a year, might say, hey, you still want this kid? And you flip him. But yeah, I think he'd be here for 2 years.
Never hurts to try.
Let's give it a shot, right? Especially when you're a team in a rebuild, you've got to try things. You never know what's going to stick and what doesn't. I mean, if you would have asked us this time, 3 years ago, is this Ferland kid ever going to make the NHL? We would have said no. So you got to give guys a shot. You got to, try them out and see what happens. Sometimes you get pleasantly surprised. And sometimes you get Mason Raymond.
Yep.
Speaking of Ferland, he celebrated a big day on March 28th. Michael Ferland celebrated 2 years sober, and he was very proud of this. He tweeted this out. He talked to a lot of media about this. Ferland was having some problems when he first got drafted by the Flames. Bob Hartley tells a story. He says he remembers Ferland sitting right across from him in his office, and that the team had seen a few red flags. And the team pretty much said, you need to get clean. It's not just about your career. It's about your life. And for those that know, Ferland grew up very poor in Manitoba. His sisters and his mom worked long jobs so he could play hockey in Swan River. And he realized that he can't throw this away. This is what he's been working for. So he's been working with the Flames. His girlfriend's been very supportive. And he's also had former Flame Brian McGrattan helping him out, who's 5 years sober himself. So congratulations, Ferly. That's quite a milestone.
Awesome job, and keep it up.
I really like that McGrattan is sort of, even though he's not a Flame, he stepped in to help with that. And I think I said to you a while ago, I can see McGrattan retiring and sort of being that league advisor, being that, substance abuse advisor for the NHL who works with all the teams.
And that would be good for McGrattan. And I could even see Ferland down the road.
Yeah, down the road. I think McGrattan would be a better advisor for young kids because he's proven that you can do it and still have a career. Ferland really hasn't yet.
Yeah.
But, you know, I mean, if Michael Ferland called me and I was having a problem, I probably wouldn't put as much stock into it. It's, well, who's this kid? He's played 2 years. Where if a guy like McGrattan calls you and says, look, I cleaned up and look at the career that I had, I think there's more weight there.
Mm-hmm.
Another shout-out I wanted to give, not as impressive as 2 years sober for Ferland, but credit to Derek Wills, the Calgary Flames radio commentator. His partner, Peter Labardius, went out sick before the Minnesota game, and Wills had to call the game entirely by himself, doing both play-by-play and color commentary. And I thought it was a little bit amusing to hear when I listened to the Minnesota game. You could tell that it's not something he's used to doing, and sometimes he's given color commentary and you're missing part of the action. So good for him for being able to keep up with that in his head while he's trying to do some color and then get right back into it and not get mixed up. And he also did the Arizona game alone. He was joined by Pat Steinberg in Calgary for the Chicago game, but good for Wills. I guess this is, I didn't know this, Matt, I don't know if you did, but I guess it's very common in the AHL when your team is on the road to do both jobs. The AHL, they don't want to send two commentators on the road, so they generally send the play-by-play guy and he does both.
Yeah, well, that's more budgetary concerns. That's it, yeah,
it's budget, but so he has that experience from the AHL, but good for Wills. It was a really interesting broadcast to listen to. Not saying I'd want it for every game, but it was interesting to listen to. So good for him for doing that. I thought that was awesome. And I know you don't listen to the radio a lot. Have you heard Derek Wills at all?
Yes, I have.
Yeah, and we're now, I think, at that point where with Wills, he's not the Peter Marr replacement. He's now the voice of the Flames. What do you think of Wills in that role?
He's getting better, slowly but steadily.
I no longer compare him to, oh, well, he's not as good as Peter. He's now the guy to me. And I agree with you. There's still some progress there, but he's learning along with his hockey team, I think.
Well, even Peter Marr said that it took him a couple of years to really figure himself out.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and create a new identity for yourself. How are you different from the last guy?
Yeah. So it usually takes 3 or 4 years to get under everything under your belt and all that. Like, even if you look at us, like the first couple of seasons that we did this, it was a huge learning process for the pair of us. And
for sure. And, you know, I think Derek Wills, at first I wasn't a fan, I think just because of Mari in my head is the Flames voice. But I'm starting to enjoy listening to him. And he's got a different style for sure, but it's nice to hear something different. You get so used to one thing for a while that, yeah, I think Wills is doing a great job. And I think having a veteran guy like Peter Labardius with him has really helped him out as well. You know, Peter Labardius is a seasoned color commentator. This is a guy who makes, I think, especially last year, made Wills look good. And it was interesting to hear him and Steinberg call the Chicago game. I listened to it on the Fan 960 website because they're now posting the complete games. But I think that they've got these guys in the right roles. I think Wills is the right play-by-play guy, and I think Steinberg is the right guy to host the call-in shows. You can just tell. It's hard to call a live game. You and I have done it, and I think Steinberg just doesn't have the training for it. So nothing against him. He just, you know, it's hard to do.
Yeah.
And I guess one last note here for the week before we get to our predictions is Mark Giordano, our captain, has been named the Calgary Flames Master and Trophy nominee. I believe every team submits a nominee for this, don't they, Matt?
Yeah.
And so for those that don't know, the Masterton Trophy is named after the late Bill Masterton, who passed away after an injury he suffered in a game in 1968. And the award every year goes to the player that best exemplifies the qualities of perseverance, sportsmanship, and dedication to hockey. And do you know who votes on this one?
Not sure.
No, I know some of them are like the hockey writers and that sort of thing. But when I hear those quotes of, you know, perseverance, sportsmanship, dedication to hockey, I think that the perfect fit for that is Giordano. It's often,
especially coming off of that significant arm injury last season. And
exactly. And if you look at it over time, it's often been awarded to players who've come back from an injury, especially one that could be career threatening. Just looking at guys who've won it where. So, yeah, that makes a lot of sense, like you said. And I just checked, it is the winner selected by a poll of the Professional Hockey Writers Association, which anytime we see those kind of things, they tend to slant eastern because I think there's more of them in the east. But I think I'm trying to find the last Flame who's won it, if any. But I think the Giordano would be a good candidate, especially for a guy who is on a team who's looked great, but the team just hasn't played well. This could sort of be that runner-up trophy for the Flames. We've had a couple Flames win it, it looks like. 1995-96, Gary Roberts won it. And 82-83, Lanny McDonald won it. So those are the only two other Flames to have won the Masterton Trophy. And I don't know about you, Matt. I've always thought this is one of the coolest-looking NHL trophies. Have you ever seen it? It's the one with the cups and the flame on the top?
Yeah.
So I as a kid, when I, you know, you see the trophies and the different video games and stuff, I always thought this was one of the cooler looking ones. I thought with the flame coming off the top as a Flames fan, I always liked the look of it.
So yeah.
Giordano, I think, was a great nominee from the Flames. I'm not sure how the Flames selected that, but yeah, good for him. I hope that he wins it. Well, you ready to look ahead to next week, Matt?
Definitely.
Before we do, let's talk about last week. The Flames had three games, as we mentioned off the top. There was 6 points on the board, and I'd predicted the Flames would get 2 points, and they beat Minnesota. You thought that they'd get the big goose egg and walk away with a loss in all three. And it wasn't, I mean, it wasn't a bad assumption looking back, but I get 1 point on the week for getting the right number of games, so I'm now only trailing you 4-6 instead of 3-6. I'm getting back up there. I can still win this one, Matt.
Yeah, you just have to get the next 2 weeks right. And
or get both the points in the teams this week.
Yeah.
We'll see. Why don't I already have my answer locked in here, but before we talk about it, let's remind everyone that the Weekly Predictions is brought to you by our friends at TickTix. There's 2 Flames home games left, and if you want to be there, you got to make sure that you use TickTix to get a seat at the Dome. TickTix connects the Sea of Red to buy and sell tickets securely from their phones. TickTix lets sellers sell for free and verifies the sellers so the buyers won't get ripped off. Tickets are delivered digitally, so there's no hassle in trying to meet somebody in some alley somewhere or some parking lot, trying to pick them up and run off to the game. It's a pain in the butt. I've been there. I've done that. You can download TickTix today for free in the Google App Store the Google Play Store or the iOS App Store. We have 2 home games left. We have the April 5th game against the Kings and the April 7th game against the Canucks. If you want to be there for either of those, make sure you get your tickets through TickTix. And for those that don't know, I'll give you a hint. Generally, at the end of the year, there's some really good giveaways if you go to the home games because they're trying to blow stuff out. We're already starting to see that. Matt and I were at the Chicago game, and they were doing, 40% off third jerseys? So if you want some good stuff, either cheap or free, get to the Dome. Use TickTix and get some tickets. So, Matt, this week the Flames have 3 games in the docket till we record next. The Flames will have to make their way into the Honda Center to play against the Anaheim Ducks. The next night they'll be in L.A. taking on the Kings, and then they'll be playing on Saturday against the Edmonton Oilers. What are your thoughts on the 6 games on the board, or 6 points?
Well, you already got your picks locked in, so you go ahead.
I think the Flames are going to get 2 points, and they're only going to beat the Oilers. I think they're going to break the NHL record for losses in one building. They're going to lose to the Ducks. I think that the Kings are going to be a handful for the Flames, and I think that they should be able to beat the Oilers pretty handedly. So I'm going
to go the opposite of last week. I think they're going to get 6 points.
You think they're going to win all 3?
Yeah, why not?
Wow.
I think with the youthful enthusiasm of the team, I think that they'll shock people in both Anaheim and L.A.
So you think they break the curse? Of all years to break the curse, the year when nothing else is going on, let's break the Honda Center curse.
Why not? And sure, they'll beat L.A. and Edmonton will fall by the wayside, no problem.
Wow. Well, I think if you can get through the 2 California teams, you got Edmonton. I mean, if you beat the 2 California teams and you fall to Edmonton, that's pretty terrible.
Yeah.
So I can definitely see him being Edmonton. I'll be interested to see if you're right. I'm hoping you're right, but I don't see this Honda Center curse being broken anytime soon. But I hope you're right. What goalies do you think we see play this week?
I think Backstrom will get in one of the games. I wouldn't actually be shocked if he played the next one.
Shake it up a bit in the Honda Center. He's the only goalie I think that hasn't played in the Honda Center. Of guys, because we played Ordeo last month, I believe, in the Honda Center. Let me double check that.
Yeah.
No, we played Hiller last time we were in the Honda Center on February 21st. So maybe they play Ordeo there. But yeah, I think Backstrom will get one of the back-to-backs. And then I think after that, Backstrom plays every game, unless they decide to put Ordeo in for the Minnesota game. But I think Hiller's done. I think if we're going to see goaltenders now, it's between Backstrom and Ordeo. What about you?
Yeah, I would assume that it'll be Ordeo for four of the games and Backstrom for one of the back-to-backs and the Minnesota game.
And as of the time we're recording this, no goalie has been announced for the Ducks game, so we'll see how that works. But yeah, I still think Backstrom, I don't think he'll be back next year, but I think he deserves another shot this year just for the work ethic he's put in.
Mm-hmm.
I think he's...
Can't argue with you
there. I think he probably retires after this year, honestly.
I can see that, too.
I don't think you're going to get a taker in North America anyways for a 38-year-old goaltender. But we'll see how it works. So, Matt, I'm hoping you're right here. I hope we break that Honda Center curse and beat the Kings. And I think for a team, especially a young team as we're seeing right now with all the call-ups who have something to prove, this would be a great week to prove it.
Yeah. Well, I just don't want to keep having to talk about the stupid Honda Center curse for the next how many ever years until we actually win a
Forever.
Game there.
We'll never win in the Honda Center again until one of these teams relocates. Wouldn't that be terrible?
Yeah, like pretty much.
30 years from now, we're still talking about this Honda Center curse. Like, the building will be ripped down, and we still won't be able to win in their new building. I don't know how old the Honda Center is, but yeah, maybe we'll be cursed there forever.
Yeah, who knows?
Were we cursed in the pond? Because the pond was a different building. I don't know how we'd...
I think so, too, because we've struggled there since, like, 2000. We've only got one win since 2000.
Yeah, it's crazy. I was in Anaheim a couple years ago, and I went to a Flames game there, and I was all excited. Then I remembered, oh, crap, I'm sitting in the Honda Center. Of course, they didn't win. They couldn't win. So, I don't know. I hope you're right, but just in my gut, I don't think this is the year.
No.
I think in my gut, as much as I'd like to think you're right, I think in my gut...
Hopeful ignorance, I'm, you know, more so than anything.
Yeah, I honestly think it's going to be one of these things that's going to happen when the Flames get hot, they run for the playoffs in 2-3 years, and they finally break the curse. And, you know, one at a time, it's like, okay, things are turning around for this team. And I think those are going to be some of the signs that, oh, wow, you know, it might be our time to run for that cup. But we shall see. You have a good week, Matt, and we will talk to you next week as we look down the barrel of the last few games of the year after that.
Yeah, and we'll be recording next Monday instead. So
yeah, and we'll be looking down the barrel then of the last three games of the season. So hopefully lots to talk about in an eventful away stand, and make sure you guys are getting your tickets for the last two home games, because those are coming up before you know it.
Thanks for listening, everybody.
We'll talk to you next
week. Have a good week.
Fireside Chat is hosted by Dan Stevenson, co-hosted by Matt DeBorg. This episode produced and edited by Peter Marino. Fireside Chat is licensed under Creative Commons license. For full license details, visit firesidechat.ca.